The OptiFlex just keeps evolving, what can I say? What is up everyone, my name is Ken, also known as Wiltshire. Welcome back to another video. In today's video, we'll be having a look at my modified liquid-cooled Dell Optiplex 3040. Now, I've named this build OptiFlex, and if you aren't familiar with OptiFlex, I have an entire video series on modifying this bad boy right here, so there will be a link to that playlist in the description below this video. So if you want to see the very beginning of OptiFlex, you can go ahead and do that, and then come back to this video at a later time. Now, there was a bunch of people in the last video that I did on OptiFlex, which was, I believe, painting a motherboard, and that motherboard is holding up just fine, by the way. A lot of you left the suggestion, or rather challenge, if I could try and liquid cool OptiFlex, and I gotta say, it definitely wasn't easy. Oh boy, where do I even begin with OptiFlex? Getting it to be liquid cooled was quite the challenge, and I will get into the problems and hardships first, but I also want to mention that there will be benchmarks after the full explanation on how I managed to liquid cool this thing. So if you want to skip that, there'll be a time code in the upper right-hand corner of the video that you can click on if you want to skip my explanation here. So that will be versus the air-cooled version versus the liquid-cooled version of OptiFlex. So the first issue that I ran into was obviously trying to figure out how to liquid cool this thing. And now, as you can see on the inside of the OptiFlex case, I don't have much room, and I originally wanted to do a full custom reservoir water pump combo with hard tubing, but unfortunately didn't have the room for that, so I threw that idea out the window and went with an AIO instead. Now, even trying to find an AIO was difficult in and of itself, and I spent 4 hours trying to look for one on the internet. And the problem was is that the case for OptiFlex only allows a 70 millimeter radiator in size, and I ended up finding one. Only one, and that was a Dynatron L6 R1. Now, the problem with the Dynatron L6 R1 is that it is a GPU AIO, and it's made for servers. So I had to figure out a way on how to adapt the AIO to a CPU. And luckily, I had a dead H100i laying around with its mounting hardware. So I took the mounting hardware from that H100i, and I went for broke and tried it on OptiFlex on the inside here. And luckily the mounting hardware worked beautifully. It worked so good. I got so lucky, and I can't express how much luck went into that in trying to mount the CPU. It was crazy. I was so blown away that it actually worked. So that was one hurdle that I cleared. The next hurdle was, as I was testing it, and you can see the picture here, I didn't record much because I didn't have high hopes for this video actually working out or even being able to liquid cool this thing, but in the end, I did get there, but I didn't film a lot of it, but I did take pictures. So in this picture here, you can see that I was just testing things and I had the radiator dangling. And as I was testing things, it dawned on me that the radiator's tubing was too stiff and too short for me to mount it on the back of the OptiFlex case, which meant that I had to cut that tubing off, drain the fluid, and then retube the thing with new tubing. Now, the tubing in and of itself is very difficult to find during a pandemic. And Home Depot got my order wrong 3 times, and it took over the span of 4 days for me to get the correct sizing of tubing, but we got there. Once I had the correct sizing of tubing, I had to fill the loop, obviously, and I used EK cryofuel for that, and that took a while. I don't think I took any pictures of that or any video of that because it took very long. It took me like 2 hours because I was struggling to do it, but I got there eventually. I think I still have a water bubble inside the loop itself, but at this point, I don't care. So after I got everything filled, I ran into another issue. And that was trying to figure out the correct orientation of the water pump on the radiator. Now, if you aren't familiar with Zotac, Zotac is what manufactures pretty much all the AIOs that you find on the market, like NZXT, Corsair, and whatnot. They have a patent on having a water block inside the actual water block that goes on the CPU. So other manufacturers like Dynatron have to get creative where they put the water pump. Now, unfortunately, Dynatron decided to put it on the outside of the radiator. It kind of looks like a tumor, actually. And this caused a lot of problems with me fitting the radiator inside OptiFlex. The orientation that you see on the inside of the computer here is the only option I had. The water pump ended up hitting the Ethernet port on the inside on the motherboard, and it also hit the edge flap here on the inside of OptiFlex's case where the side panel meets, so I couldn't put the side panel on. So that was the other issue. The other issue that I ended up running into was that the fan that was bundled with the L6 R1 ran at 5,000 RPM. It sounded like a hairdryer. So I had to find a replacement fan, or rather two replacement fans, and ended up finding a 70 millimeter, 15 millimeter thick fan from Evercool, which was 70 millimeters. And trying to find a 4-pin PWM 70 millimeter fan is also difficult. A lot of them were 3-pin, and I wanted to be able to control the fan speed. So I found that on frozen CPU, and luckily that worked out just fine. And lo and behold, everything went together after that pretty cleanly. And this is the final product that you see now. So with the hardships and issues out of the way, we're gonna get into the benchmarks of this guy here. I haven't even had the time to benchmark this myself, so we're gonna get into that now, and hopefully it beats out the air-cooled version of OptiFlex. Okay, so I've just got OptiFlex set up in the background here, and we're ready to stress test OptiFlex, but one thing that you have to do when testing AIOs is you have to let the fluid inside the radiator and water block actually reach equilibrium. And a lot of people make that mistake. They actually test just an AIO right out of the box with cold fluid, and they actually get better test results than you normally would by just letting it idle for a little bit and warm up. So while that's warming up in the background here, we're going to go through my previous data with the painted air cooler that I did. So I've got everything on a whiteboard here, and you have to excuse my writing. I'm left-handed, so my writing is not as neat as it normally would be. However, I'm going to be going up against the painted air cooler that I did in a few previous videos against the Dynatron L6 R1. So on the painted cooler, the hottest core reached 67 degrees Celsius after 20 minutes of stress testing. And I used RealTemp GT for the temperature readouts, as well as monitoring the frequency. And we'll be using IDIS64 to stress test the CPU. So I'm also going to be locking the RPMs of the intake fans on the front of OptiFlex and on the radiator itself to the exact same RPMs that I used for the painted air cooler, which was 1710 and I believe 1540 for the intake fans. So we're going to just let this warm up a few more minutes, and then I'm going to hit the stress test button, and then we'll get back to you guys when I have the final test results. Okay, so I've been letting OptiFlex stress test for about 21 minutes now, which means it's time for some test results. Now, I just want to add that I did let this warm up for about 11 minutes. Normally, you want to let a AIO warm up for between 15 to 20 minutes, but this is a 70 millimeter radiator, which means it has a lot less fluid in it than a, say, a 120 millimeter radiator or 240 millimeter radiator. So that is why I let it only warm up for about 11 minutes. So with that said, the warmest core, and I have my whiteboard here on the 6700 using the Dynatron L6 that I modified. And if we have a look at my whiteboard here, and the test results are in. So the test results are the Dynatron L6 actually beat the painted CPU cooler. So it actually wasn't all for naught. It beat the painted CPU cooler by 3 degrees after about a 20 minute stress test. Actually, the Dynatron was actually testing for a little bit longer, about a minute and a half longer. So it actually outperformed the painted CPU cooler and is on par with the non-painted CPU cooler. So in the end, to answer my own question, was it actually worth it trying to get the Dynatron L6 to work inside OptiFlex? I think so, because it was kind of cool. I don't think you've ever seen a friggin' liquid cooled Dell OptiPlex 3040 ever in your life. So, I mean, I'm probably the only one to have one, maybe. I don't know, maybe someone else beat me to it and they just didn't record it, but I think it still looks pretty cool. I've always liked the look of AIOs compared to air coolers, but there's definitely a lot of risks involved, definitely a lot of headache involved with getting a radiator AIO to fit inside this thing, but it was a pretty fun video nonetheless. Thank you all so much for challenging me on trying to liquid cool OptiFlex here. I'm probably gonna keep the way it is. I'm definitely gonna remove that Intel sticker on the water block. I'll probably try and whip up a kind of maybe an addressable RGB kind of disc that goes on the top of the water block there. But anyway, guys, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Hope you guys enjoyed this little experiment. If you guys wanna see more content like this in the future, hit the like button and subscribe button. I'd very much appreciate that. My name's Ken Alcinone as Wiltshire. And as always, I will see you guys in the next video. Thanks for watching.